Morning. We are in Clanwilliam at the Clanwilliam Lodge. Stayed here over last night. Also had dinner here. Very lovely dinner we had. Now we're getting ready. We're going up today to Nieuwoudtville. So yeah, the Clanwilliam Lodge. Very beautiful lodge here in Clanwilliam. So if you're ever in the area, I can recommend you to come and stay over here. Very beautiful lodge. So we're on our way now to Nieuwoudtville.
We're going into the cedar bog a bit further. We're going to Nieuwoudtville. You can see a little white collection. It's a small one.
Very beautiful view down the valley.
We splashed our tanks, as the Australians say, in Clanwilliam before we got on our way up the Papkuils Pass to our first stop. Englishman's grave. This historical site has a bit of a sad story about an Englishman who got shot and died here in 1901 during the Second Anglo-Boer War. He was hastily buried, and as the story goes, his family, who was well off in England, paid for a gravestone and fence to be built around it. The soldier's sister came from England by ship to Cape Town and to this site by horse carriage for 30 years. In 2020, some mountain bikers came across a shallow grave covered by rocks, which turns out to be the actual grave site where the English soldier was buried, instead of this monument next to the road.
Yeah, we had some lunch here at Die Nedersetting in Nieuwoudtville. Very lovely lunch. Yeah, so this is Papkuilsfontein guest farm. It is a working sheep farm and cattle farm, where they also have accommodation and a restaurant, so where you can come and do a bit of a farm tour. You can come and enjoy the restaurant or stay in beautiful farmhouse accommodation. Can really recommend Papkuilsfontein guest farm. Come and stay.
We went with Willem, or better known as Mariette's husband, on a farm tour. He has been farming here for decades and told us so much. At first sight, it is a beautiful landscape, but he told us so much of what we would never have imagined to see around us.
So that's where the name Papkuilsfontein, that's where everything started, because of the permanent water. And people come all the way to fetch their water here.
For their guest farm, they restored some of the old ruins of farmhouses into guest rooms. Guests can book these rooms to come and enjoy the tranquility here and enjoy hiking or the many mountain bike trails.
Between 200 to 300 years old. It's made from ant hills. The ant hills, and they make it in the mud and then they box it. It's hard. They also use it to make tennis courts, you know. Instead of nectar or pollen, so they're very what we call a specific kind of thing. Pollen, yeah. So they discovered a new species here, and they're still doing research on, you know, how they survived through the whole season. Yeah. This old building, everything they used to build this is from this area.
Yeah.
It's not, there's no pollution or whatever. It's gone. It's back to nature. Not only rain, because the rain is coming from the west. Yeah?
Ah, yes.
Yeah,
right.
You see, the same as this is how it grows wild.
Yeah.
The same as these ones.
Yeah.
So what they do is they cut about two-thirds of the bush and leave one-third for regrow. Mm. So this one, these upper part are all rooibos, but yeah, these, the rooibos that you buy was cultivated from these wild ones. So what happened is very interesting, because by breeding or cultivating, you breed for one specific quality, you might lose another one. So what happened here, if there's a fire in the field, these wild rooibos will resprout. But if there's a fire in the plantations, it's all dead. Yeah. So the other thing is, if you buy rooibos bags, the machines work better using fine material. So the fine material is mostly the leaves, and that's not your best tea. The best tea is just the woody part.
The whole thing.
Yeah, this is your best. So if you buy, you want to buy real good rooibos, you don't buy it in bags. You buy the loose rooibos, and then you put it in a little strainer, put boiling water over it, and you have your rooibos. Yeah. So you can take this if you want to make your rooibos
real rooibos.
But also very interesting, you know, if you look at the thickness of the cracks, if you look straight here where the sun shines, the layers of sandstone is very thick. Yeah? So if you look to your left, the layers becoming thinner and thinner. Yeah. And at the waterfall where the water came down, it's on there thinner. So that's why this canyon is going that way. If you look to your left, it's becoming thicker again.
Yes. The butter tree. This is the elephant's foot. Very thick inside, like very hard, and then these short branches with little leaves on them. And according to this sir, that's also where cortisone came from. Yeah, this is the Oorlogskloof Canyon. Formed over millions of years, cutting into the softer sandstone.
Yeah, this is one of the, well, this is not the original or the normal Bushman painting. It's unusual in a sense that it's very enclosed here. Mm-hmm. Normally they're in big over rocks, you know, big rock faces. It's very primitive, and they think it was done by a witch doctor or a shaman who lived here on his own. He painted what he saw while he was in trance or hallucinating. But also, the other thing is, what I tell you is only speculation, because nobody knows. There is also some stories. There was one guy here, an
anthropologist.
And his theory was that it could have been made by people even before the quarry was sunk, because it's unusual and it's black and all that. Because one thing is that, I'll explain this later, is that he asked me also for stone structures on the farm. And there was about 2 kilometers that way, two stones upright like this, and the flat one on top, and one standing up here. And we, the old people, my father told me that it was probably a wolf cage where they catches wolves, but there was no wolves in South Africa. Maybe to catch leopard or whatever, but it doesn't make sense because it's a heavy stone and stuff. So that guy was standing there with his compass, and he asked me to take a picture on the 23rd of September, that's the equinox. And I was sitting there waiting for the sun to set, and that was, sun was setting directly west of that structure. So, and the funny thing is, or the, yeah, funny, not funny, interesting, that this site is directly west of that structure. So he was the guy that, well, he reckoned that even people before the Bushman could have made these paintings. Yeah, we don't know how old it is.
Do you know how these were found? Were they already known to be here, or did someone just...
No, this was also, you know, I knew, I thought I knew about all the paintings or everything on the farm, but there was in 1980, 86, there was two boys who stayed in the ruins before we renovated those cottages, and they came to me and said that they saw this painting with a snake on it. And yeah, I came here and was quite surprised to find this. So I contacted the expert in Wits University of
Johannesburg,
and Lewis Williams, he was the expert in Bushman paintings those days. He came with two students and made a trade dressing, and he also included in this in one of his books. And what I tell you is more or less his interpretation of what he sees going on. Yeah, if you maybe from the crack there, or out of the crack, this dragon, along the red face, there's the eye, if you look closely, probably the eye, and then the scales on top, like a dragon, and attached to this, now these, I think it was food bags because of the roads. They're attached to this, all along this dragon. This is probably one painting with a human. There could have been a second leg because there's two arms. It's without a head. That's the same with this one here, this without color. The head is gone. That's the same. There's a human being with the feet up. And the half moon, like this one also, there's a human being, because the half moon, because the indigenous people very dark hair and a lighter brown complexion, yeah? So they painted it with black, and probably the face was yellow or white, and that eroded away, and only the half moon remained. The other thing is that you can see there's a line going through there. See there, that line going all the way, and as I said, this. That, so it could have been a very colorful painting with more than one color, but only the red and the black remained because the particles of this color was the finest, and it penetrated maybe deeper into the rock. So it stayed long. Other thing you will notice, the logo of the farm, that little thing there, long legs like a human being, body like an animal, you see the sign of a tail, and wings like a bird. That's our interpretation, like a three-in-one bird, human, animal figure. You see the whole, this whole thing was painted there, there, something here. So I was wondering, you know, what is that dragon looking at? Yeah, but the rain is coming from the west, so there's in winter always water coming in here, destroyed these. But it was discovered in 1986, and from then to now, I can't see any deterioration in this painting. And I always thought, you know, if they hang the Mona Lisa here, it will not survive very long. But the sun is also shining on this picture every afternoon, and it's still there.
What did they use for the paints?
That's also that we don't know. We assume that they use the black ones, probably charcoal, mixed with something else. You can find this red, yellow, and white ochre on the farm. On the area you find stones, and you, if you break it open, it's filled with red or yellow ochre. And that's probably what they used for.
It's pretty remarkable find.
I think it is unusual. You know, you have a lot of paintings, Bushman paintings, and so very beautiful ones. Yeah. The Cedar Butte Mountains. And there was a guy from France, and when he got back to his home, he sent us a book of the paintings in the caves in France. It's called something like that. And it's remarkable, the similarity of the Bushman paintings in South Africa and in France.
Yeah, we have some in the top end of Australia called the Bradshaw paintings.
Yeah.
And they're similar in style, but not meant to be connected. But
we spent the night at Papkuilsfontein's De Lande accommodation, which is an old farmhouse that has been converted into a guest house. We got served the most delicious home-cooked meal for dinner, and this morning we were brought back here to the guest farm for the biggest spread of the most delicious home-cooked breakfast again. After breakfast, we all went back to the Oorlogskloof Canyon. They provide an activity where visitors can swing out over the canyon from a ledge on the side of the canyon. While connected to a steel-reinforced cable that are bolted into the rocks, it's called the Via Ferrata. A few of our group were brave enough, but we all joined for the scenery.
Okay, yeah, have fun. See you on the way out.
Unfortunately, it was too far away for us to see when they were swinging over the canyon. But afterwards, we also went to the Motorcycle Museum in Nieuwoudtville. You can catch my next video where I show you the motorcycle museum. If you like this video, please like it and subscribe to my channel. Thank you for watching. See you next time.